the Jewish Channel's Week in Review. Republican governors make their case to Jewish political donors, Jewish kids from across the globe singing together, and why this Jerusalem Post columnist wants to abandon the peace process. It's the Jewish news that's changing your world right now on this episode of the Week in Review. Hello and welcome to the Jewish Channel's Week in Review. I'm Stephen I. Weiss. As we prepare this broadcast, news is breaking that suggests the Israeli-Palestinian peace talks could be about to kick into high gear or about to fall apart. A claim is hitting the wires that Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas is canceling meetings with Secretary of State John Kerry and planning to file for Palestine's recognition as a separate state with more than a dozen international bodies. This could suggest that peace talks have no hope at all, or it could be a gambit to push negotiations further. Other reports suggest a major concession from the U.S. to Israel of possibly freeing convicted Israeli spy Jonathan Pollard, who has been imprisoned for nearly three decades for spying on the United States. Those who see this as a significant move on the part of the U.S. think it might presumably only come in exchange for major progress in peace talks on Israel's part. At the same time, some are suggesting that with Pollard reportedly declining in health, there simply might not be much further opportunity to use him as a bargaining chip, and so this says little about U.S. hopes for progress. It's a bewildering set of events that could have any mix of truth, posturing, or outright lies. Sometime soon, we might well know what is actually going to transpire, and sometime after that, why. But however things go under the administration of President Barack Obama, the world got a preview of the kind of president leading Jewish Republicans would like to see. The Republican-Jewish Coalition, or RJC, held its annual conference in Las Vegas, home to billionaire casino magnate Sheldon Adelson. Adelson reportedly spent $92 million on the 2012 election and has said he plans to spend far more money in 2016 and to do so far more effectively. Indeed, as it was put in the Washington Post, this year's RJC gathering was a sort of Sheldon primary in which potential candidates would vie for Adelson's support. Those appearing included New Jersey Governor Chris Christie, Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker, and Ohio Governor John Kasich. A small tempest brewed with Christie referring to the, quote, occupied territories when he was talking about the West Bank.
I took a helicopter ride from the occupied territories across and just felt personally how extraordinary that was to understand the military risk.
For many in the RJC's audience who don't agree with international consensus on using the term occupied territories, this was seen as offensive. Christie later clarified to Adelson that he meant nothing specific to the politics of Israel by his use of the term occupied territories. Moving on, an international choir of Jewish high school students recently performed at Carnegie Hall. Christian Eden reports.
One of America's most storied music venues, Carnegie Hall, was filled with choral music this week, sung by 300 members of Hazamir, the International Jewish High School Choir. Last year, TJC took you inside the Manhattan chapter's preparations for Hazamir's 20th anniversary concerts. This year, we saw the final rehearsal of more than 20 Hazamir chapters from as far away as Israel before the organization's largest performance of the year. TJC spoke with Hazamir director Vivian Lazar about coordinating the repertoire for such a far-flung group of young singers.
In order to get the sound that we have to have a very structured program. So not only do we all learn the same repertoire, but we send our conductors musical information so that they can teach the repertoire in a similar way.
One of those conductors is from the new Beit Shean chapter in Israel.
And they come from the city of Beit Shean and from the region, the kibbutzim around. And it's actually a very important community project because it brings all kind of settlements in Israel together. And usually they wouldn't come so often together.
Lazar said that coming together is a core principle of Hazamir.
We say in Hazamir that the only thing that makes us different is we are sopranos, altos, tenors, or basses. Otherwise, we look for our samenesses, not our differences. And we're very proud of the culture that we've developed in Hazamir, where kids come from different Jewish denominations. Some come with no Jewish knowledge whatsoever, but they all learn to respect each other. And our goal is to make literate Jews.
Matthew Lazar heads the Zamir Choral Foundation and created Hazamir in 1993. He explained the importance of Jewish youth singing choral music with Hebrew text.
If you're dealing with text, you're dealing with culture. If you're dealing with text, you're dealing with history. And this is the way in which we educate our young people without their really knowing it, because they just think they're having fun. But they're learning the history and culture of the Jewish people while they're having a great time.
For more about Hazamir at Carnegie Hall, please tune in to the full broadcast edition of The Week in Review.
Thank you, Christian. Passover is coming soon, and there's a new way to look at the Haggadah on your mobile device. Meredith Gansman has that story.
The late philanthropist and founding chairman of Hillel, Edgar Bronfman, was never satisfied with the Haggadot he used to lead his seders. So he wrote his own, and to illustrate the text, he turned to an artist close to home, his wife, Jan Aronson. The Bronfman Haggadah, published in 2012, would be this husband and wife's last collaboration while Edgar was alive. But it was the first time Aronson illustrated a text.
I wanted it to be as personal to me as Edgar's text was in writing for him.
So all the drawings are done by hand. But in this digital age, even the most traditional texts and techniques are available in an app.
This is the Brahma Haggadah app.
The app tells the story of Passover and also plays music and shows video to teach more about the story of Passover and the rituals of the holiday. And look, search Haggadah in the App Store, countless results come up. Passover, even more. Have the people of the book become the people of the app? Mark Perlman is a media specialist.
Are we ultimately become the people of the app? You know, I think for a certain group, maybe it'll be part of their experience with Judaism. I don't think it'll replace the book. I do think that the experience of Judaism is enhanced by these kind of technological applications.
I'm hoping that we have the next generation of Jews who are brought up with this technology and feel very, very comfortable with it, who will just go to it automatically.
To learn more about the Bronfman Haggadah, tune into the full broadcast version of The Week in Review.
Thank you, Meredith. This week, the Israeli-Palestinian peace process is driving a lot of headlines, but there's a far-right faction in Israel that would like to see the peace process end, and for Israel to govern the West Bank in the same way it does the land within the Green Line. Jerusalem Post columnist Carolyn Glick is the author of The Israeli Solution, a one-state plan for peace in the Middle East. My interview with her is included in this week's episode of Up Close. Also this week on Up Close, historian Thomas Cahill, author of Heretics and Heroes, and former Israeli intelligence operative and current novelist Chagai Carmon. Here are some highlights from my interview with Carolyn Glick. So what you're advocating with this book is the idea of abandoning the two-state solution and going for basically Israeli governance of everything.
Yeah, I mean, the policy that I set forth here, which you just described, applying Israeli law and sovereignty to all of Judea and Samaria, has now become really the policy of the majority of the members of the Likud Knesset faction. It's the policy of the Beit Yehudi Party, which is a major coalition partner in the government. And it's just sort of percolated among larger and larger circles of Israelis because, you know, over the past 20 years, Israelis have recognized the basic fraudulence of the peace process and of the PLO's protestations to peaceful intentions. We can't leave on our own with no deal. We tried that in Gaza, and we've gotten, you know, more than 13,000 missiles, rockets, and mortars shot at Israel from the areas that we vacated. So Israelis are more and more coming to this policy, and what's really pushed it forward was the discreditation of the whole demographic time bomb theory that if we don't do it, we'll be overtaken.
Right. One of the key principles underlying the idea of two states is that of a two-state solution is that Israelis and Palestinians are best side by side rather than together, because Palestinians would come to overtake a Jewish majority over time. And in a democratic system, they'd win.
The problem with that whole argument is that it's based on falsified data that was put out in 1997 by the PLO. That was a Palestinian Authority census that proclaimed that by then there were 2.8 million Palestinians or something in Judea and Samaria. They inflated the numbers by over 1.3 million people.
We've seen Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, whom you used to work for, has in 2009 come out for a two-state solution, come out for a Palestinian state, is right now, you know, at least saying that he's engaging in peace talks with an open mind. Do you think that he just doesn't acknowledge the same facts you do? Do you think he's wrong?
No, I think neither are the case. I think he's dealing with certain political realities vis-a-vis the Obama administration that are compelling him to make these statements. But, you know, interestingly, I mean, I don't have a problem with much of what Netanyahu says, because what he says is, we want a true peace and not a piece of paper, and the Palestinians aren't prepared to make an offer to us that we can survive with.
It's not entirely true to say that Netanyahu has these positions as a result of Obama's rhetoric or pressure. Nearly two-thirds of the Israeli electorate for some time has supported a two-state solution. That's the electorate that elected him. And he has stated with some detail why he believes that this is good for the security of Israel.
Yeah, fabulous. I mean, I would support a two-state solution if it enabled Israel to survive. There is no way that the two-state model will work. It can't work. It's never worked. It never will work. It's never going to get anywhere, because the basic guiding ethos of Palestinian nationalism, as I discuss in my book at length, is a negative ethos. That is, it's not directed towards establishing a Palestinian state in any positive sense. Rather, it is geared towards the destruction of the Jewish state.
You can see the full episode of Up Close on the Jewish channel on cable. You can also listen to the full audio of Up Close as a podcast, available on iTunes or in your favorite podcast player. That's all for this week. From all of us here at the Jewish channel, be well. Jewish channel is available on cable. Time Warner Cable Channel 528, IO Optimum Channel 505, RCN Channel 268, Bright House Channel 330, Verizon Fios Channel 900, Cox Cable Channel 1, Frontier Communications, and on Comcast in the on-demand menu under Premium Channels. For more information, visit tjctv.com.